Let's look at the blind scope management process in more detail. This process helps you think about all the work you've got to do to make sure your project is focused on delivering the correct product. As we said before, planning is inevitable and essential in all the knowledge areas. The scope management plan and requirements management plan are the outputs from this process. There are also components of the project management plan. The scope management plan is a document which provides guidance and direction on how the project and the product scope will be defined, developed, monitored, controlled, and validated. It's the same with the requirements management plan, which will guide you on how to collect, manage, and document the requirements of the product or project. Let's look at the inputs for this process. What do we need in order to develop the scope management plan? We begin by analyzing the information contained in the project charter. So the first input we need is the project charter. The project charter is the output of the develop project charter process, which is in the initiating process group, and it's also a process in the integration management knowledge area. Don't forget, plan scope management is part of the planning process group. And like we said before, we can use inputs from processes in another process group. And the outputs will be used as inputs for processes in other process groups, like executing or monitoring and controlling. Remember, the project charter is the most important document because it formally authorizes the existence of the project. It's the trigger for initiating the project. We'll explain the project charter and its contents in detail during the integration management knowledge area. But for now, all you need to know is you have to use the project charter information in order to complete the scope management plan document. The project charter documents the project purpose, high-level project descriptions, the assumptions, constraints, and high-level requirements that the project is intended to satisfy. It contains high-level information, risk, schedule, finance, key stakeholders, etc. By the way, if you see high-level, summary, or overview in the PMB exam, the question is usually about the project charter. As you can see, here we have a template for the project charter. The elements of the project charter can be tailored based on the project needs, size, type, complexity, and so on. In this template, there are 4 pages, but in real life, you will end up with 20, 50, or more. Let's explore the most important elements. We start with the project title, for instance, data warehouse project, ERP project, or combined building project, or anything. We also specify the project sponsor and the project manager. It's important to remember these points, especially for the exam. One of the primary purposes for the project charter is to assign responsibility to the project manager. As project manager, you don't start working on the project before you have the authority to manage it, which is given to you through this document. Also, we describe the purpose of the project. How does the project tie into the organization's strategic goals? For instance, the purpose for this project is to maintain the building and to create solar power to save electricity and to make it environmentally friendly. We include a high-level description of the project and specify the key deliverables, the major requirements, and the major risks to the project. Here we have 3 major objectives of the project: scope, time, and cost. We can also include quality or business value, strategic objectives, business objectives, etc. We discussed project objectives in Chapter 1. The project objectives state what the project must accomplish in order to be successful. In the project charter, we specify high-level success criteria for the project objectives. That means how we measure these objectives. The criteria are used as a baseline, and we compare them with the actual project performance. For instance, the scope success criteria is fulfilling the contract terms and conditions. The scope sets the boundaries of the project, so it can be done successfully. It's the same for the time or cost objectives. For instance, the success criteria is to finish the project within 1 year and $100,000. Then we have the summary milestones. Milestones are markers of achievement in the project, such as the completion of key deliverables or the completion of a project phase. We'll explain this in detail in the schedule management knowledge area. The next section is pre-approved financial resources. This is the initial cost estimate for the resources that will be used in the project. We also specify the key stakeholders and their roles in the project. Don't forget that we define all the stakeholders in a different document called the stakeholder register. But here, in the project charter, you identify the key people or groups. The last section here is budget management and variance. Budget management refers to the authority of the project manager to commit, manage, and control project funds. Variance refers to the level at which variance needs to be escalated. For instance, if you've spent more than the project budget, you'll need to escalate the issue to the project sponsor. On the last page of our template, we clarify the authority levels and responsibilities for both the project manager and sponsor assigned to the project. For instance, the project manager has a staffing authority, which includes the power to hire, fire, discipline, accept or not accept project staff. Finally, we have signatures. Let's go back to the inputs for plan scope management. As we said, we need to use the project charter because it may impact how we plan the scope. Then, from the planning process group and the integration knowledge area, we need the project management plan, which includes all the plans from all knowledge areas. Here specifically we want the quality management plan, which I will explain during the quality management knowledge area. We use this because the way we will manage the project and product scope can be influenced by how we implement our company's quality policy, methodologies, and standards. For instance, if the company is using an ISO or CMMI quality standard, then we'll have to take that into account because it might affect how we plan the scope. The next input from the project management plan is the project lifecycle description. The project lifecycle is what you need to do the work. It's the phases that the project will be divided into from the beginning to the end of the project. For example, we can have the analysis phase, design phase, build phase, test phase, delivery phase, etc. We need to think about these phases in the project lifecycle because when we are planning how the work and the scope will be done, we will do it in these phases. We also have to think about the development approach. This is how we will do the work. For instance, do we want to do the work sequentially, which would be a waterfall approach? Or do we want to do the work in small batches so the customer gets to see value from the beginning, which would be agile? Or we could use different approaches like iterative, adaptive, or hybrid development. The last inputs we have to plan scope management are enterprise environmental factors and organizational process assets. I explained both of them at the beginning of Chapter 2. Both EEFs and OBAs can affect the process of planning the scope management. They can also impact many other processes. They will be used as inputs to most of the processes. This reminds us that one size doesn't fit all, because the factors which can impact a project negatively might impact another project positively. Sometimes a factor like infrastructure can extend the scope of one project, but might limit the scope for a different project. Remember that the EEFs are outside our control and the OBAs are documents. Since we are project managers, we have to be aware of these factors in order to manage our projects successfully. The enterprise environmental factors which affect the scope contain the organization's culture, the infrastructure, personnel administration, and marketplace conditions. organizational process assets, OBAs, within the scope contain places and procedures and historical information and lessons learned. By the way, many students have asked me about personnel administration, since the PM book mentions it sometimes as EEF and sometimes as OBA. The short answer to this is it could be either EAF or OBA, depending on the situation. Personnel administration that focuses on the organization or enterprise is more of an EAF. This is because it contains influences, including organizational policies for hiring staff or policies for outsourcing or hiring consultants. However, policies that apply to projects specifically or policies that are part of the PMO can be considered as OBAs. For instance, if there is a training policy for this particular project, we would consider this aspect of personnel administration as an OBA. So, we have to consider that information which is standard across the whole organization is an EEF, but any policy related to a specific project is an OBA. Now that we've discussed the inputs, let's look at the tools and techniques we'll use. Remember, the inputs for any process are what you need. The tools and techniques are what you'll do or what you'll use. The outputs are the results you'll get, which you will use for other processes. The tools and techniques you will use for plan scope management are expert judgment, data analysis, which includes alternatives analysis, and lastly, meetings. We will start with expert judgment. You will see it appear throughout the whole PM book guide. We use expert judgment through the whole project lifecycle in every process group and every knowledge area. So it's the most common tool and technique in project management. When we use expert judgment, it means we obtain the knowledge and experience of someone who's an expert or who has a previous experience in whatever subject or activity we need for the project. Remember that this expertise can be provided by anyone or any group of people who have specialized education, knowledge, skill, experience, or training. Our second technique is data analysis. You'll use this in many processes. We use data analysis techniques to organize, assess, and evaluate data and information. All projects have their own data. For instance, data regarding the finance, data related to the contractors, to the project performance, data associated with risks, etc. This can all be used to support decision making. Understanding what the project data is telling you is critical for making good decisions. So the amount of effort you put into data analysis can have a serious impact on how successful your project will be. One of the techniques that can be used for the plan scope management process is alternatives analysis. We can use it to evaluate various options or approaches we've identified, so we can select the most suitable ones for executing and performing the project work. In plan scope management, alternatives analysis allows you to evaluate the various options or methods you have for collecting requirements, elaborating the project or product scope, creating the product, validating and controlling the scope. Remember, you always have to look for other options. Project management is not fixed. You can't say, I've already planned, so I won't change anything. Or, I always collect requirements using this method, so why do I need a different method? You may find alternative options more effective, so you must be flexible and always look for other options to implement. The last technique is meetings. Meetings are an essential activity. For instance, you might need to hold a meeting with some of the project stakeholders to discuss your plan. During the planning stage in the project, not only in the scope, you need to involve your team to make sure your plan's appropriate. In the agile approach, for example, there are daily standard meetings between the project team and the customer and relevant stakeholders to discuss the project performance and anything else that needs to be discussed. Don't forget, meetings are not always in person. You may work with virtual teams in other countries. In this case, you may hold meetings via conference calls or online using programs like Skype or GoToMeeting. Now that we've completed the plan scope management process, we have two outputs, the scope management plan and the requirements management plan, which are both components of the project management plan. They help you define the scope of your project and make sure that you and the project team are focused on only the work that will help you satisfy the project's objectives and needs. For small projects, you can combine the scope management plan with the requirements management plan. Let's see what they look like. Here we have an example template for the scope management plan. For the exam, make sure that you know the difference between plan scope management and the scope management plan. Plan scope management is the name of the process, but the scope management plan is a document which is the output of the process. All the other processes in the scope management knowledge area are defined and described in this document. So, don't be confused between these two terms. The scope management plan keeps you and your team on track by detailing the processes you will follow. As you clarify the scope, figure out the work breakdown structure, and validate and control the scope for the project. The scope management plan includes the processes for developing a detailed project scope statement. The project scope statement is an output from the defined scope process. We will talk about it later. Here, in the scope management plan, we describe the processes we need to do. We describe how we will develop the detailed scope statement. We also describe how we will decompose the project into specific deliverables using a WPS and WPS dictionary. We'll include to what level of detail the deliverables will be broken down. We need to include how we will maintain the scope baseline, which is made of the project scope statement, the WPS, and the WPS dictionary. Remember, that's for the exam. We will talk about it more in the next processes. We might also include how scope changes will be managed through the formal change control process, and how we will get acceptance for the deliverables. For each deliverable, we have to identify how it will be validated for the customer acceptance, including any procedures we need for sign-off. We also define the scope and requirements integration. Here, we describe how the requirements will be defined in the scope statement and WBS. Don't worry, if you don't understand some of the elements in this document now, we'll explore all these elements in detail in this chapter and the integration knowledge area. What you need to understand now is that both the scope management plan and the requirements management plan are documents which describe how you will do the other processes. Remember that the scope management plan can be formal or informal, broadly described or highly detailed, based on the needs of the project and based on your methodology and development approach. Now, let's look at the second output, which is the requirements management plan. Remember that sometimes this is called a business analysis plan. The requirements management plan guides us on how we'll gather the requirements. For instance, do we need to meet all the end users? Is using a questionnaire more effective than a survey? And so on. We want to think about things like what we will do to analyze the requirements. For instance, do we need to use a software application to analyze them? Basically, what are we going to do to the requirements to make sure we understand them? What requirements do we need for the analysis phase or the design phase of the project? And also, it guides us on how to document and manage the collected requirements. For instance, should we use an Excel sheet to document the requirements, or do we need to use a specific software for documentation? How we will manage and control changes to requirements? Who will approve and give a sign-off on requirements? How can we communicate them? How can we monitor and track them? There are many questions we can ask ourselves to prepare the requirements management plan. This plan is important because it describes the next process we will discuss, which is collecting requirements. As project managers, we use requirements to provide meaningful reporting on the status of the project, like how many requirements are still yet to be approved, how many requirements are postponed, which might change the scope. The other components of the plan include configuration management activities. We'll discuss these later in more detail in the Perform Integrated Change Control process. Configuration management is about ensuring that we don't end up with many documents where we don't know which one is the right version and which document is compatible with the others. Imagine you have a larger project, so there are a lot of requirements, and some of these requirements will be changed many times. In this case, you need a system to control the versions of these changes. Configuration management activities include things like how changes will be initiated, what the impacts are on the project, and how the impacts will be analyzed, how changes will be tested, tagged, and reported, what authorization level is required to approve these changes. You also need to include a requirements prioritization process. For instance, there are some requirements which are high priority and some which are low at the moment but may become medium or high later. Certain requirements will be non-negotiable, especially for the construction or safety-related projects. Some requirements are needed because of regulations from the government, and some might be required because of the organization's policies or infrastructure. Other requirements may be nice to have, but not necessary for functionality. So we need to plan the process of dealing with the prioritization. Lastly, the plan identifies the metrics that will be used and the rationale for using them. For example, we are building an elevator, and the requirement is that it must be able to support 800 kilograms. The metric may be that it's designed to support 20% extra, that is 960 kilograms in total. So, any design or engineering decisions that make the elevator go below that level need to be approved by the customer or the authorized stakeholder.